See what happens.
Love that red button.
It's a big square red button. You can't miss it. Sticks out like a big sore red button. It's a big square red button. All right. Ladies and gentlemen, the Ponch to my John, the Cagney to my Lacey, the Cream to my Sugar, the host with the most, please put your hands together for Mr. Ben Blackman.
All right. Good morning, everyone. I'm not sure I deserve that kind of introduction, but thank you all for tuning in once again to Virtual Coffee with Ben. My name is Ben Blackman. I'm the Director of Development for RIDG, which is Royal Innovation Design Group, a group of innovation consultants based in sunny St. Petersburg, Florida. Before we get started, I'd like to encourage you all once again to subscribe to the RIDG YouTube channel and to our Facebook page, where you can like and share all of our great content. You can also schedule your own virtual coffee session with me, where we can talk about how we can help your company to innovate more effectively. Virtual Coffee with Ben, which is what you're watching, focuses on how companies strategically plan for the future, how they innovate, and how they create a strong culture for their employees. Now, today, we have a very special guest for the show, and it just so happens that our guest, he's the main man in black. He is the guy running the show. He's doubling as a guest today. His name is Joran Oppelt. Viewers of the show know him as the Director of Creativity and Innovation for RIDG, but what you may not know is that he is also a published author, and he's here today to talk about his newest book. It's an upcoming book slated for release on October 13th. He co-wrote it with RIDG Chief Innovation Officer and Founder Michelle Royal. It's called The Visual Meetings Field Guide, so we're going to be talking about that today. Of course, we have Philip Leslie on as well. Philip is one of RIDG's many talented visual strategists. He's going to be doing a graphic recording of today's interview, which we'll be posting after the show. Good morning to both you guys. Hope you're doing well.
Good morning.
All right, Joran.
Good to be
thank
here.
Thank you again for doubling as a guest. I wanted to talk to you because your newest book, as I mentioned, is going to be released on October 13th. And I'm really curious to learn more about it. But before we kind of dive into that book, I wanted to talk a little bit about your background as a writer. This is actually not your first book that you've published. Can you take us back to when you knew that writing was something that you were good at and something that you wanted to pursue professionally?
Good at, I'm still figuring out, and that I wanted to do probably pretty young, though it was comic books when I was a kid. I would take these little pieces of paper and staple them together and then draw little comic books. I mean, saying like 6-7 years old, you know, little stories, like mainly like based on like classic universal monsters like Frankenstein and Dracula, things like that. But yeah, I was always making up stories. Oh, and I did get in trouble. I remember I got in trouble one time because I wrote similar, like a stapled little booklet, in, I don't know, first or second grade. And it was a story called Pat the Bat. And it was a story that lived in Wisconsin at the time. And, it was a story about a pet bat that I had that lived in our basement that I would go down and feed, you know, and all these like really rich details about our basement and like what was on what wall and whatever. And it was, you know, just this story about this pet. And the teacher kind of like not confronted me, but like asked me, like, do you really have a pet bat that you're feeding in your basement? And I swore up and down that it was true. I told her, yes, I have a pet bat named Pat. And, you know, she called my mother in. And she was like, we're just a little worried that, you know, you're putting your child at risk by letting him feed the bat in the basement. And it was a lie. It was fiction, total fiction. It was my first work of fiction, I guess.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So when did you delve into nonfiction? So what was your process like to get to where you are now? Obviously, you're quite a reader, as we can see behind you. Have quite the collection of books.
I'm a book person.
You are a book person. So how did you go from Pat the Bat to writing about creativity and innovation and facilitating meetings?
Yeah. The first couple books I have are really, spirituality based and self-help. They are, one is specifically about building spiritual community. I'm also the founder of something called the Integral Church, which we started about 8 years ago. It's kind of like this global interfaith movement. And so I wrote the book on how to convene circles and how to facilitate those circles and how to influence and inspire more interfaith or pluralistic dialogue in your community and how we might, rethink and reimagine religion in the 21st century and in the age of postmodernism. So that was my first kind of big book. But before that, I put out a little book that was called Sentences, just like little sayings. And that book, Sentences, was literally an experiment of like, oh, you can publish on Amazon. How do you do this? You upload a PDF, right? It was just figuring out how to self-author.
Got to start somewhere.
That's right.
So what is your process like when you get an idea for a book, whether it's Sentences or whether now it's about visual meetings? Does it start with just that idea and then you say, hey, I want to write a book about this, or is it just kind of evolve?
I mean, I can tell you my process. It's, talking to a lot of writers, it's different for everyone. A lot of people are happy to just sit at a computer or a device and type away and bang away at it. I find that really hard to do. I tried to be that kind of writer for a long time and found out that dictating, verbally dictating the work and then transcribing and then cleaning it up, through the editing process was best for me. And then I could work the language into what I was really trying to say, right? Because I think we write differently than we speak, but you have to start somewhere. So even if you're just record yourself talking and then transcribe it and you got a head start. At that point, it's Google Docs, it's Google Drive, it's just collecting what you're working on. It helps if you are, there's this maxim of like workshop the book. You got to teach it for a while before you write it and release it. You have to kind of become kind of an expert on what it is you're talking about. And it's helped for me to have, I used to own a place called the Meta Center, which was, a community space. And so I would teach all kinds of classes and stuff there. And then at Integral Church, I would have, 15, 20 minutes on Sunday to just speak about whatever. So I was writing these talks and things. So a lot of that stuff has been collected into a Google Drive as lectures. And there's another book I'm working on now, Spiritual Edge, which is a collection of those essays and talks. So, the question about writing process becomes, you can sit down and write a book, or you can, teach a bunch of classes and then go back and collect your syllabus and put it together. And, for me, it's like there's this process then eventually of, okay, I got to print everything out. And I have to take visual inventory of everything I've written and lay it out on the dining table or the bed or wherever you are. And then see like, oh, okay, there's a chapter here. There's a chunk of stuff here. There's a theme. There's like five writings about this common thing. And then there's this other chapter here. And at that point, you're fleshing out your table of contents, right? Your skeleton of what you're working on. And at that point, you can see what you're missing. Because if thematically you're missing a whole, rationally missing a chunk of, well, how do we get from point A to point B? Well, then you know what you have to work on. You know what your writing assignment is. You got to get the reader from one point to the other. So there's a process that I have that, again, every writer you talk to is different. Everybody's got a different way of going about it.
Yeah, it's really interesting that you're using the recorder, though. I just think of Charlie Kaufman in the movie Adaptation, played by Nicolas Cage, when he's just constantly speaking into his tape recorder and jotting down everything. So that's kind of how I envision you scrambling around in your free time, just downloading all of the totally. Things from your brain into a recorder and then transcribing. That's an interesting process, and obviously it works really well for you. What was it? I know that at RIDG, you're doing a lot of visual meetings, both in person, and now you're doing it virtually. At what point did you think, okay, I got a book here? I want to take all of this
knowledge
that I have on this subject and then put that into a field guide. What was that like?
Yeah, that was client demand is what that was. I mean, Michelle, who is the co-author of this book, and I realized pretty quickly as the clients began to ask for just guidance, just advice on how to run meetings. They saw how we worked and they saw how RIDG runs meetings and they said, that's magical, right? Like, that's amazing. We want to figure out how to do that. And so can you just write up some best practices? And that's how it started. I just sat down with Michelle and I rolled tape on her and I said, here's a few questions we've gotten. Let's start out just interview style and, you know, tell me what you got. You know, what if the manager isn't buying into the, you know, what you're pitching at the meeting, or what if you got the wrong people in the room, or what if you got people in the room and they're not engaging, you know, how do you get to the best idea? And all of those questions that were coming up around how to really get to powerful and productive meetings visually, right? Because that's how we do things, is always visually, just became a little, like I said, a Google Doc. And we were dumping that thing out as a PDF for years, just sending it over to clients. And we kept adding to it and adding to it. And at that point, you know, you're about... I'd say about 3,000, when you get to about 3,000 words in, you're like, oh, this is more than just a Google Doc. You know what I mean? And at that point we realized, well, let's start to organize the information we have. And it was later in the process then that we realized, well, if it's a visual meetings field guide, it's gotta be visual. And so, you know, we approached Philip, who's on the call doing a graphic record of this call right now, to be our illustrator. And he did amazing work throughout this book, illustration wise, to really bring these themes to life. We're really proud of it. It's really cool.
And what was it like working with Michelle on that? So I know you already had a lot of information just working with her all the time, but how did you make sure that you were both happy with the final product?
Yeah, I mean, she's a fountain of knowledge, you know, from having interviewed her. Yeah. And so I think that there were points where we knew we had what we needed as the kernel of the book. And then we realized, I think at one point that, like I said, like on the dining table process, like there were some things we were missing. Like if this is going to be an actual book, there's some things that are missing. And I filled in a lot of that myself, but there were some things that I think we went back for a second round and we're like, Michelle, what about this? What would you recommend here? You know, what are some best practices? And then here real late in the game, because I'm, you know, as one of the delivery people at RIDG and involved with conducting and facilitating the client experiences, I've kind of become this expert on Mural and Zoom and things like that. And it became real clear. We were ready to go to print with the thing in, what was it, February, March? And we were like, oh, wait.
Yeah. What happened then?
Meetings are not going to be in person for a while. So we pulled it. We stopped the process of publishing it and added this huge chapter on virtual meetings and how best to facilitate virtual meetings. All kinds of stuff like chat tags and best practices on Zoom and icebreakers and how to use Mural to your advantage as a third kind of collaborative space in meetings. And so we added a lot of material, and that's, I think, what a lot of people are going to get a lot of value out of.
Fantastic. Well, if you're just joining us, you're watching Virtual Coffee with Ben. I'm Ben Blackman, Director of Development for RIDG. I'm joined today by Joran Oppelt, who's usually running the show, but today he's also the guest. He's the Director of Creativity and Innovation for RIDG, but he's also the co-author of an upcoming book called The Visual Meetings Field Guide. We also have Philip Leslie on the call. Philip's one of our visual strategists. He's doing a graphic recording of the call. Again, if you like what you're hearing, want more content, feel free to subscribe to the RIDG YouTube channel or check out our Facebook page for more conversations just like this one. You talked about kind of the process of writing the book and having to stop during, you know, the pandemic to add in more virtual tips and tricks. What do you expect the readers to be able to gain out of this? Who is your target audience? And what do you hope that by the end of it, that they gain out of it?
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because we, in the beginning, in the very beginning of the book, we say, you know, who is this for, right? And we're kind of addressing the reader. It literally is for anyone who is running a business and is tasked with having those meetings be effective and productive and meaningful and transformative, you know, not just effective, but, you know, do your meetings really feed the business? Are people in the room for a reason, and are they contributing in the right ways? I would say it's also for, let's say, teachers who in the COVID classroom, right, are trying to find ways to increase participation and engagement and make things fun and find tools that work. I think they get great value out of this book. I mean, literally anyone who, if you're a chair of a nonprofit or chair of a committee, or right, what, anyone who has to convene people together to get things done is going to get something out of this book.
Mm-hmm. What did you learn about either yourself or about visual meetings in general throughout writing the book? Were there things that you discovered that you might not have anticipated before you started?
That's a hard question because we're always learning. You know what I mean? That's part of what we do at RIDG is we're always trying, you know, I've joked on here before about how we play with innovation best practices like an 8-year-old plays with Hot Wheels track, you know, it's just like, we're always trying new tools on and experimenting things and running processes and getting people in a room to test either a canvas or a process or whatever it is, right? So we're always playing with that stuff to see what works because we want to know what works. I don't know that I tell you what I learned, what I realized maybe is that now more than ever is what is the right time for a book like this. There's tons of books on meetings. Like you go on Amazon, you go on to the bookstore, there's all kinds of, you know, turn your crappy meeting into a great meeting, right? There's a lot of our book, I think, is really rooted in our values, the RIDG values, in the power of human potential and making magic moments happen. And, you know, we are really committed to bringing our values to life. I think we do that through our meetings and through the engagements that we have with our clients. So I think now more than ever, when people are, you know, in a mindset of fear, or it's FUD, right? Fear, uncertainty, doubt, right?
If
they just don't know. They don't know what's happening tomorrow. They don't know if they're still going to be working with this team tomorrow. All of this stuff that's happening in the workspace is all the more reason for when you get together with your team, you got to make that a powerful experience. You have to make that a human experience, and you have to be collaborative, and you have to make sure everybody's voice is heard and everybody feels valued, and that it, you walk away at the end with deliverables from the meeting that were like, man, I'm glad I was at that meeting. I'm glad I didn't miss that meeting. And how many people can say that? People mostly just sit through meetings and like, oh
yeah,
can't wait for this thing to be done. You know, like that needs to stop. Like if that's happening, then you don't have that meeting, you know? Mm-hmm. So if there's anything that I realized, it's that every meeting needs to be visual and every meeting needs to have a little more human touch in it. And I think that's what the book does.
Right. Well, speaking of visual, I was hoping maybe we get a sneak peek of the cover here. I know that it's not yet on shelves. So if you could tell us a little bit about the rollout plan and when people can actually purchase the field guide while you pull up your PDF of the cover so we can take a look at some of the great work that Philip's done.
Yeah, let me take a look here and see.
And Philip, if you want to jump in for a moment, I'd love to know what your experience was like going through and doing the illustrations for the field guide.
Yeah, sure thing. It was a fun experience. So we did this entirely remote. I think this kind of all, the project started obviously before COVID, and we were still working the project entirely remotely. I would receive emails or texts from Joran and Michelle. I would sit down at a coffee shop and do the drawings, and then I would send them back and forth for feedback and final touches. And I think COVID hit, and then they asked for some more drawings as they were going to add obviously the virtual and digital components to the book. And so, yeah, this entire project from an illustration standpoint was done 100% remote, and it was a blast.
Oh, we know just through the work you've been doing for the show that you're extremely talented, and I'm excited to see all of the great illustrations throughout the book. We can at least see the cover here. This is the Visual Meetings Field Guide. Joran, tell us what all we can expect to find inside.
Yeah, this already is hit the on cover some of it. And the spine, this is kind of the what we've uploaded here to Amazon, and it's like it's got Philip's illustration on the cover. The book design has been done by Todd Bates, who is a really, really amazing book designer. He's done work for Gibson Guitars and the Bob Marley Estate and Marvel Comics and Star Wars. He's done all these big, beautiful coffee table books. And I had the privilege of working with Todd at Creative Loafing when he was the creative director and I was the marketing director there. We're really thrilled to have David Sibbett, who is the kind of the father of visual thinking, the author of Visual Meetings, Visual Teams, Visual Consulting, that are available on the Wiley imprint. He is the head of the Grove Consultants based out in California, and he wrote the foreword to the book. And so we're really, really honored to have his contribution. And Haley Temple at Mural provided an endorsement, which was a thrill. So yeah, this is the cover. And I can give you a sneak peek of the table of contents. It's kind of broken down into three sections. You've got meeting design, where you're making decisions about what the meeting needs to be. The second section is virtual meetings. So this is the section that we've added that is all about the weird things that happen in virtual space, trying to look at a virtual wall and guide people's attention in two dimensions instead of three. And what happens to time when you're in a meeting virtually? It's different. You lose time in some places of the meeting and you gain it elsewhere. And it's important to know where those things happen and plan for them. Visual Meeting Toolbox is really full of like our Apple, you know, Spotify playlists and checklists and all the stuff that we run every meeting with. The ORs, which is how you kick off every meeting with your objective agenda rules and roles. That's how you ensure you have an amazing meeting. There's all kinds of things in the toolbox that that are valuable.
Fantastic. I love that we got the music playlist in there as well.
Yeah.
As viewers of the show know, it's always good to start with a little bit of music. Well, yeah. Joran, I certainly appreciate you hopping on to give us a little insight into the book. We will certainly be talking more about it as we get closer to October 13th, which is the official release date. We'll be sure to blast out on social media all the great places where people can find the Visual Meetings Field Guide. But certainly want to thank you again for joining us.
Absolutely. We'll do a book launch event or something. Absolutely. We should do like with Michelle, and we'll do an official book launch where we can have a, you know, physical copy and walk people through it. Maybe we'll do an unboxing video when we get the copies in hand. And yeah, so stay tuned for all of that. And Visual Meetings Field Guide is volume one in the series of RIDG books. The Facilitation Fundamentals is coming up next. And there's a book on innovation in the works as well.
Fantastic. Can't wait for those. And again, if you're interested in learning more about RIDG, you can always go to our website, which is www.ridg.com. That's RIDG. And go to our YouTube channel and Facebook page for more content. So I'd like to thank once again, Joran Oppelt and Philip Leslie for joining me today. And we will see you next Wednesday at 9 a.m. Take care out there.
Thanks, Ben.